a rebel, didn't wanna behave. Thought a wretch like me could never be saved. But everything changed, I remember the day when I heard him calling my name. Like a thief in the night, he snuck in, took my life. I was dead, now I'm alive and singing. I got stolen by the grave robber. Pick me up from that rock bottom. Wash my soul in that holy water. Brought me back to life. One more stone rolled away. One more sentiment saved by grace. This dead man, he ain't dead no longer. All because of that grave robber. Maybe you're the one thinking that you'll never be right. Even though your mama praying for you every night. Thinking Jesus gonna find you and open your eyes. Well, maybe right now's that time. Like a thief in the night, he'll sneak in, take your life. That resurrection gonna have you singing. Well, I got stolen by the grave robber. Pick me up from that rock bottom. Watch my soul in that holy water. Bring me back to life. One more sentiment saved by grace. This dead man, he ain't dead no longer. All because of that grave robber.
Taking my sin, taking my shame, breaking my soul out of these chains. I'm a dead man living, and God did it. Taking my sin, taking my shame, breaking my soul out of these chains. Well, I've been forgiven, and I got stolen by the grave robber. Pick me up from that rock bottom. Wash my soul in that holy water. Brought me back to life.
Well, I got stolen by the grave robber. Pick me up from that rock bottom. Wash my soul in that holy water. Brought me back to life. One more stone rolled away. One more sin I've been saved by grace. This dead man, he ain't dead no longer. Jesus is the rock, and he rolls my grave away. Jesus is the rock, and he all because of that grave robber.
Woo! Before you sit down, turn around, give somebody a high five or a fist bump. Tell them good morning. Good to see you here this morning. Glad you know the people around you a little better, at least see their face, and know that there are people here with you today celebrating an awesome day. What do you say? Yeah. And so this is why we come to church every Sunday, is because Jesus rose from the dead. And because he rose from the dead, it means that our lives can be risen from an old dead life. And I'm glad for that in my life. And I'm sure if you know him, you know how great that is. And if you're here today, trust me, you can know that for sure in your life too. We have a few things just to let you know. First of all, if you're a guest today, we are so glad you're here. Thanks for coming and being a part of Fair Creek Church. If you're viewing us online, we're glad you're watching. Thanks for tuning in. And please come and join us sometime. And then, as a part of today, we want to welcome you. We have a special thing we call Guest Connect. It's back, right back by the big letters F-O-R, because that's what our church stands for, is what we're for, not what we're against. And so, what we're for is for you today, if you're a guest, to stop in to Guest Connect and just meet me. I'll be there. I have a gift for you. I want to just talk to you a little bit, get to know who you are, and just welcome you. So please, won't take long. Just stop in, say hey, and on your way out. All right, so that's great. And then one of the things that's very, very important is that we've got some things coming up that you may want to know about. And to know those things, the best way is to look at the QR code on the seat in front of you. All right, so if you're on the front row, you got to use something else. They're all over the lobby or whatever, or go around and you can check back there. You guys do that? You can do that for me, right? All right, so make sure you get that QR code. It'll take you to our church app where you'll find all the information you need. One in particular is how you can give to Fair Creek Church and all the ministries that we do here in this church and in our our community. And so we would encourage you to participate with us and to give generously. A great way for us to experience God in our lives is when we give of what we have. And so it's an awesome way to worship Him. But then you also find that there's a thing there called Circle Up. And that's going to happen a week from this Tuesday, April 9th. We have short-term small groups that are going to begin. And at that time, you're going to see a whole list of different groups that are available for you to be a part of. And when I say short-term, we're talking anywhere from 6 weeks to about 9 weeks that you can come on Tuesday nights, connect for about an hour or so, and be in a small group with people, get to meet people, but also talk about things that maybe are relevant to your life. Everything from how to study the Bible to how to be a better parent. And so you can see those all on the church app. We would hope you'll do that. We'll have something for you as you leave today so that you can get more information. And so make sure you pick one of those up as you go out. And then coming up on April 12th, a Sunday, we've got, for those, how many of you have preschool kids? Anybody have preschool children? Raise your hand real high. We want to see it. Okay, let's take a moment and let's pray. Okay? Now, we know what it's like to have preschoolers, and so we have a special day planned on April the 12th. Our preschool theater is over next door. You're going to want to be there. It's all on the app. You'll see the information. Please come back on April the 12th and be a part of that with us. You know, there's great things going on and lots of things that are happening, and we are so excited to see God do amazing things here. And so one of the things that we are seeing a lot of here recently is people taking their step of baptism. And what a great day to do baptism, huh? Because baptism is all about what Jesus did on the cross and then the fact that he was buried, but then he rose again. And when someone believes that in their heart, the Bible says you're saved. If you can believe that for the forgiveness of your sin, well, we have people taking their next step after they trust Jesus, and that's to be baptized. Because you identify with Christ. As you step into the water, you're identifying with him on the cross for your sin. And then when you go into the water, identifying with his burial. But when you come out, you're identifying with his resurrection. And that's why we're here today, right? And so today, we get to see that as a part of someone's life. And I want you to meet her. Her name is Heidi.
Hi, I'm Heidi, and I have been at Fair Creek for 1 year now. I was invited to Fair Creek through a friend, Renee. Our boys went to school together. We were painting one night and she was like, hey, I've got this great church that I go to, you should come check it out. And I grew up, you know, pretty open to a lot of religion. You know, I always give a church a chance to see what it's about. So I was like, yeah, let's give Fair Creek a chance. The difference that I find with Fair Creek and every other church I've been to is this is the first church that distinguishes themselves as Jesus followers. That's interesting to myself because as you read the Bible, you know, you see Jesus' disciples and what are they doing? They're following Jesus. You see all the people that, you know, followed Jesus into the crowds, all that stuff, all the people he healed. They were Jesus followers, and I love that the people at Fair Creek identify themselves as not just Christians, but Jesus followers. I have been going through some tough times lately, and there was just one day where I was just having a really hard day, and I was on Facebook, and I saw, you know, that the 29-hour experience was going on, and I got off work late and I was like, hey, I have time, I'll go check it out. I went into the rooms and I'm doing the whiteboard thing. I just write down all of the sins I want to be forgiven for, you know, and in that moment when I was just sitting there by myself and just Jesus, and I was just like, man, I was like, it's this simple. All I have to do is just give my problems to Jesus, just ask him to forgive all my sins, you know, and they're gone. They're not, you know, like, they're not my problems anymore. Jesus is going to take care of it. And after, you know, I got invited to community group, it was pretty cool. Like, I was able to connect with people my age, you know, people that had kids my age, which was awesome too. And I made friendships. It's really great because you get to learn from those people that you're with in your community group. They make me comfortable. They're there if I need help with anything, if I need a friend to talk to. We're also considering getting a community group tattoo. We all help each other through hard times, and it just becomes more than just a community group. It just, you know, it adds to your army, and that's what you need in this life, is not to go through life alone. I was baptized as an infant. This time, I'm drawing a line in the sand. This time, this baptism is for me. This moment on, I'm following Jesus with my heart, and I'm hoping to show others that they can do the same. It's me coming to Jesus. It's not other people saying, hey, you should do this if you want to be a part of the church. It's me and Jesus having a talk, saying, I believe in you. I believe you died for me on the cross. I believe that day that he was on the cross, he was thinking of me, and he was thinking of you. And when he rose, that just showed proof, that showed us the proof that we can have eternal life in heaven with Jesus. I'm Heidi, and I want everyone to know that my faith in Jesus has changed everything.
Heidi, it's really exciting to be here with you this morning and to watch you take these next steps, to have our community group all here, kind of excited to be a part of this with you, to have your boys here. What a better example could you ever give for your kids than to take the step of following Jesus and to tell that in front of everybody here. And thank you so much for sharing your story with us so that we could hear about it. And so Heidi, because of your profession and faith, it is my honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in new life. Well, folks, Jesus went to the cross and died to pay the penalty for our sin, but he rose again 3 days later so that we could have a personal relationship with him and to restore our ability to have a right and restored relationship before God. And I don't know about you, and maybe I don't know if everybody here would agree with this morning, but I can't think of a better way to celebrate what a personal relationship with Jesus means than to see the power of what it does. What it does is it changes and it transforms lives. And that's what we've been able to witness here this morning. Would you guys join me and pray for Heidi, for her family, and for this decision that she's made, for her continued growth in her personal relationship with Jesus? Let's pray. Lord God, I just thank you so much for this day and for this time for us to be together and to be able to witness what we have seen here this morning. I know that Heidi would be the first one to say that this whole thing isn't about her. It's about what Jesus has done in her life and what a difference having a relationship with him has meant to her. And being able to share that with her friends and her family is really important to her. And God, we are just incredibly thankful for what you have done for us, the sacrifice that you've made for us, and allowing us to have that personal relationship with you, and allowing us to have a hope for the future, to know that we will be able to have that restored relationship with God. We will be able to be with him. And God, we are just incredibly thankful for that. We celebrate that today. Thank you for Heidi and for her testimony, for being willing to share that with us today. I mean, how incredibly cool that she came to the prayer time kind of thinking, well, I'll just check it out, not having any idea what would happen, and then giving her life to you. Now, that is a powerful and impactful story. And Lord, I pray that you will use that to continue to help her to grow in her relationship with you, and use that to inspire and encourage the people that are here getting to hear it and witness it today. Maybe It's time for them to take that next step with you. God, none of us are easy to work with. I think we can all admit that. So thank you for being patient with us. But God, I pray that you would draw those folks to you this morning. God, we love you. We are so excited to be here to celebrate you and what you have done for us and the hope that we have because Sunday came and you rose from the dead. I mean, none of this means anything without that. Thank you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing, but not alive. Thank you.
Tower, you have a you have two red light violations and two school zone violations. Is there anything you want to tell me about them?
I didn't know I was doing this stuff, Your Honor. Right. Evidently, the Pleasant Valley Parkway ones is going to the VA.
We're going to look at the red lights, okay? We're going to look at them. The light's red, and that's your vehicle. And the second one, Lisa, is 462. You also have two speeding tickets on Charles Street.
I looked at that, Your Honor. That must be taking my daughter to work. I can't see how I was speeding, though.
All right. Now, you were going to the VA hospital?
Yeah.
Were you in the service, sir?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're. What branch of the service?
See my
No. What branch?
Your Honor.
Yeah. Where did you serve?
Vietnam.
You were in Vietnam?
Yeah.
How long were you in Vietnam?
66 to 68, Your Honor.
Mm-hmm. 2 years.
Yeah.
You know, I have a very particular affinity toward those that served in Vietnam. Number one, because of the service to our country. And number two, because of the way they were treated when they came home.
I'm not looking for anything special as far as my military service, Your Honor. You know, that's up to you, your discretion.
No, you didn't bring it up, I brought it up.
Okay.
And you are just like all of the other Vietnam veterans that I know. They're not looking for anything, right? They're all real men. They're willing to take it on the chin, and they're not looking for anything special. And unfortunately, when they came back from Vietnam, they weren't treated the way they should have been treated. Yeah.
It's terrible.
Yeah. Did you have any of those experiences?
I'm sorry?
Did you have any of those experiences
Yes.
when you came home?
Yeah. Yeah.
The total fines are $270. How much can you afford to pay?
I'd have to pay, like, in a time thing, Your Honor. I'm on a set income, you know? So if you can give me some time to pay it up, I'll pay it.
How much can you pay?
I don't know, Your Honor. Whatever, you know.
What have you got with you tonight?
I don't know, $50 maybe, something like that.
Sir, I'm going to charge you $25, and your $25 payment is going to be paid by one of the many people who have sent in contributions to this court to be used in my discretion for people that I think are worthy. So I'm going to fine you $25. You don't have to pay it. Okay? So it's going to cost you nothing. So as far as you were concerned, the case is dismissed. We appreciate your service in Vietnam. Thank you for your service, and good luck to you.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Good luck.
You.
Gotta love a judge who understands the circumstance that this man found himself in, right? I mean, here he was, obviously guilty, you know? And the judge, on his own, decided to do something about it. Because he could, because he cared. He had this deep sense of emotion and commitment, connection, he said, to people who are serving or who have served, especially during the Vietnam War. I don't know if you've ever thought of yourself in a circumstance where you know you're guilty, you know? You ever had a situation where you know you're guilty and you are trying your best to not have the judge or whoever judge you? And maybe it's a relationship, maybe it's a broken relationship, maybe it's a situation in family or with friends, or maybe experiences, maybe it's things that you've done on your own and you can't even forgive yourself. It's so difficult to get through, and all you can hear is the judge's mallet. Well, today, as we look at this, we look at a situation, a story that many of us are very familiar with, an event in history that many of us are familiar with. We come to an Easter Sunday, and we hear this regularly on an Easter Sunday, that Jesus rose from the dead. And what significance is there to that? This whole thing, one of the things I read this week was that many people now believe that all the events that happened, they're highly likely to believe, even the resurrection of Jesus, but they see no relevance to their own life. I mean, that's a hard one to think about, but it is possible that in a world with so many distractions and difficulties and problems and lots of guilty people, that we could lose the relevance or the significance of something so important as this Easter Sunday. So when we think about this, you think about God going through what he went through, and each one of us have probably this idea in our minds, but I want to ask you to think about this a moment. What was God thinking? What was he thinking? I mean, he actually came through a process here. He took guilty people who, by every right, should have to pay for the guilt and the problems and the issues and all of the problems in their life, all the sin, all of those things. It was, he should have had them pay for it somehow. How can you pay for this? And unfortunately, a lot of us think that we have to pay for things. We do it. Have you ever had a relationship with someone and they've held something over your head for a long time? I got to tell you, I've been there. It's not fun. It's difficult. It's hard when you know you've done it. Or maybe you've come to the realization that you did something to somebody and you're holding it over your head all the time. You know, it's something you've done in your past or something that's been difficult to get by, and you hang on to that guilt. You know, and you think, what was God thinking that all these people, anybody can come to know Jesus? I mean, maybe you've heard that, but that's what's proclaimed. That's what we would want you to hear today. I'd want you to hear that anyone can come to Jesus and be forgiven. But what was God thinking to allow guilty people? I mean, dying for guilty people. Who does that? Who dies for a guilty person? And not only that, but what was he thinking? Resurrection from the dead? All of these things, what was in God's mind? And I come to one specific thing, the relevance of it all to any of us, any person who hears this and knows it. I think of this. I think, why? That needs to be answered. The why of it all needs to be answered. Every part of what God had in mind and what he was thinking, that needs to be answered today. I believe it can be, not because of my wisdom or anything that I would say, but everything that Jesus himself said, everything that was taught about Jesus and that Jesus left as his legacy and that what he would want us to know and to hear about. That's what we hear today. And so if you're like you're saying, yeah, that's me. I stand before a judge and I feel like I'm guilty, I can tell you there's great relevance in it. Let me tell you, go back to the day that Jesus was on the cross and that he died. Most people believe that Jesus was crucified. Most people will believe that he went to the cross and he died, and that it was not just. I mean, he had done nothing. He was not guilty of anything. And people put him up there to do this. And many people thought he was a blasphemer. Some people thought that he was a threat to the Roman government. And so everybody around him was against him for those reasons. But in Jesus' life, he had done nothing. He had done nothing wrong. You ever been punished for something that you didn't do? Now, some of us have to go back maybe to our childhood, but maybe it's happened to you at work. Maybe it's school. Maybe it's somewhere where you've had a situation and you were called out for something you didn't do. How fair is that? So why would Jesus do this? Why would God do this? What was he thinking in all of it? Well, I want to take you back to that day on the cross. And this is one of the phrases, one of the things that Jesus said while he was on the cross. And remember, he had to do this by sucking for air. I mean, he was literally sucking for air. His lungs were about to collapse under the pressure of the crucifixion and hanging on that cross. I mean, it was difficult. He was struggling to even be able to breathe and to get enough words to say this. He looks to his heavenly Father, to God the Father, who was looking down on what was going on, and this is what he said: Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. You might say, they had to know what they were doing. They had to know that they were executing an innocent man. They had to know. But did they know exactly what he was hanging there for? Did they know what he was dying for? Because a lot of people don't understand the depth of why he was on that cross. Every wrong, guilty thing we've done in our lives was on his shoulders and on his back that day. He was carrying the weight. And sometimes, you know the weight that it feels when you do something and you feel guilty for it? You know how difficult it is to carry that? Imagine carrying all of our guilt, all of the shame, everything that we have going on. Imagine that. That's what Jesus was going through. And then when he looked at the crowd, Think about it. He would have seen the soldiers there that had taken the nails and nailed him into his hands. He would have seen the people who had spit at him on the road into the place where he was crucified. They would see the people. He would see the people who were mocking him. He would see his followers who were sheepishly blending into the crowd and backing further away as they saw it. Most of them hiding, afraid to be affiliated with it, afraid they may be put on a cross themselves. And now Jesus looks and says, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." So what was Jesus thinking? What was God thinking? I think he had one thing in mind. When you think about this, he had forgiveness in mind. That was the whole reason he hung on the cross. It was the whole reason why he was motivated by one thing, and that was forgiveness. He wasn't motivated by trying to make certain things right. He didn't want all the attention on him. Actually, he wanted the attention on the sin that was being paid for that day. And forgiveness was his whole goal. Forgiveness for people who were guilty. People who could not make it through. You know, later on in Scripture, you find out that when after Jesus had died and he was buried and he rose again, he ascended back to heaven and he gave a mission to so many people, of which we're part of that today. That was to build the church, or to start the church, a movement of people. Not a building or anything like that, but it had to do with a movement of people who were standing up for Jesus. And every time someone comes to faith in Jesus, it accomplishes the goal of the church that Jesus had put in place, just like what happened in Heidi's life. And so as we think of this word forgiveness, you think of the words that then were given to a church that was struggling, believing that Jesus had really risen from the dead. Matter of fact, they had all placed their faith in that, but then it had become kind of cold in their hearts. And it had come out in the way that they were actually living their lives. They weren't living as if Jesus had been risen from the dead. They were living as if they were going through the motions of some kind of religion. And so he was challenging them. Don't ever lose this. There were some of them that were having difficulty. And we find this where Paul, who was one of the greatest men to preach the word of God and to tell people about Jesus. He was one of the ones that Jesus empowered to be the one to help churches start all over. And I would say that even our church here today is a long process and go back in history, but we're here today because of men like Paul who preached about Jesus. And so in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he tries to set the record straight with them, and this is what he says. Many of them were wondering, and he says, listen, you've got to hang on to the resurrection. You've got to hang on to this idea that Jesus died and that he rose again, because there's relevance to your lives. It's important for you. You can't just treat it as if it's something that you think about and yeah, it happened, but it should empower you. It should change your life. And so he says this. And if Christ has not been raised, now this is going to be, I'm just going to warn you right up front, I'm going to give you some what sounds like really bad news, okay? This is kind of bad, all right? So just get ready, all right? And you might, especially if you're new to faith or you're new here today and haven't heard this for a while, or you've never heard it before at all, you're going to hear some words that come out of Paul's mouth and you're kind of going to go, what? What's he doing? This isn't encouraging, okay? But listen to it. And if Christ has not been raised, if he's not been resurrected, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. How would you like to say that? You know, what we're doing here today is useless if Jesus was not raised. Everything we've sung about, everything I'm talking about, you know, everything that maybe your faith is built upon is useless if Jesus hasn't been raised. But then the words go on. It says, more than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God. He's saying, you know, basically Paul's a liar. You know, he's standing up and he's saying, look, you've got to believe this. You've got to trust this. He'd be a false witness. And then he even says about God. You're a false witness about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. They've gone that far, and if they're not talking about something that actually really happened, then they're liars. He was a liar. And quite honestly, if Jesus hasn't been raised, then I'm a liar. Then it goes on. But he did not raise him if, in fact, the dead are not raised. Here's the thing. The promise of Scripture is that people who are followers of Jesus, you know, they may die, their body may die, but they will be resurrected. And there's no resurrection for any of us. There's no hope of any afterlife. There's nothing if Jesus was not raised. And for if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. So if you can't believe in one, you can't believe in the other. You can't hope for something for yourself if Jesus hasn't done it first. So then it goes on. It says, and if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. I mean, if Jesus hasn't been raised, then what you believe in here today, any of us, if Jesus isn't raised, then it's useless. It's futile. I hate the word futile. It means it's just a waste. You know, you try to do something, you know? You ever had anything you've done that's been futile in your life? You know? Sure. You are still in your sins. That's the harshest, worst part of this passage, all right? You are still in your sins. If Jesus hasn't raised from the dead, you might say, but he died. Yes, he died on the cross. His payment on the cross paid for sin. But if Jesus stayed dead and didn't raise from the dead, then he would have been paying for his own sin by dying. You see? And he wasn't dying for our sin. He'd had to pay for his own. But he didn't stay that way. Let's just make sure we're clear on this. No resurrection, then there's no forgiveness. Okay? All the guilt, all the pain, all the suffering, everything that we go through, there is no forgiveness. There's no hope. There's nothing good. See, I told you it's bad news. Isn't that awful? It's awful. But then, goes a little further. The passage goes on. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ, well, they're lost. People who believe this and are dead, many of you have loved ones. You've lost people that were believing in Jesus. And I got to tell you, if they were believing in Jesus and the hope, if there's no resurrection, then they're lost. There's nothing, there's no hope for them. You know, I take that kind of personally. I think about people that I've lost even recently. You know, you lose your parents, or you lose a sibling, a sister, or a brother. You lose a close friend or someone like that, and their hope and faith is in Jesus. But if he didn't raise from the dead, then they're lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are all of people most to be, what's the word? Say the word. Ooh, say it again. Pitied. Oh, I hate that. I hate that word too, almost as much as futile. Pitied. I would be pitied because I would believe this. You know, if it wasn't real, there's no hope. There's nothing. See, think of it from this standpoint. If the resurrection of Jesus didn't really happen, then wrong is never made right. Wrong is never made right. All of the wrong in our lives, everything that's wrong in the world, everything, none of it can ever be made right if Jesus didn't raise from the dead. And then even beyond that, if the resurrection of Jesus didn't really happen, then there is nothing for us in this life. Nothing. This life, we just go on day after day. Now, I'm going to get real personal for a second and ask you, are you feeling like you're just going through motions in your life, period? Every day just feels that way? It feels like I'm just pushing myself through, get up, make the donuts, go back, you know what I'm talking about? It's like over and over again, doing the same things over and over again. I just feel like I'm going through the same motions every day. Nothing ever changes. It's always this, always. Can I tell you that the resurrection should shape and mold our lives to the point that it gives us hope every day? You know, I love Easter because there's a lot of hype. You know, yeah! You know, we all come and we're all excited and all pumped and everything. And then next Sunday comes and we're all kind of like, why? Because Jesus, if Jesus really rose from the dead, then today, Easter shouldn't be the only day that we're like, yeah, you know? It shouldn't be like that. It should be every day of our life. Every Sunday we gather, every time we meet in a small community group, anytime that we are on our own and we just reflect on the need we have in our lives, then it ought to excite us to know that Jesus got up out of the grave.
Amen.
Okay? Now, could take you now. Now the verses, Paul really painted a bleak picture there. If Jesus wasn't raised, it's bad news. But look at this. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. That should be like a good thing, all right? When you hear this, okay, your faith is futile if he didn't raise from the dead. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead.
Amen.
Right? The first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. When he says first fruits, he's referring to something that goes all the way back to the ancient Jewish scriptures of the Old Testament, goes all the way back to this, and it speaks of an offering of barley that would be brought to the temple, and they would always take the first bundle and bring it to the temple to acknowledge that the whole harvest came from God. That's actually why we give. As part of our practice of giving in the church and giving of the things we have, we don't spend all of our money first and go, do I have $10 left? You know, no, we say, no, I'm going to give first and then be able to do it. That's why. If you're wondering why does this happen, it's about worshiping God and putting him first in our lives and showing him that. And so we do that so that we can actually let more people know about him. And so the idea is that Jesus was the first fruit, the beginning of a promise that would happen for all of us. In this, Jesus was the first dead person that got up from being dead on his own and is still alive today.
Amen.
He didn't die again, okay? They didn't have to go through a second funeral and bury him again. If that were the case, then Jesus wasn't Jesus, all right? He wasn't a resurrected Lord that could actually die for sin. But he is still alive today. Now, that's an amazing thing already. And he was just the first fruits of this because that's hope for anybody. Now, Paul didn't just write to the Corinthians. He wrote to the Romans too. He wrote to them in Rome because they saw a lot of persecution going on. There were a lot of people who were martyred for their faith in Rome. And so listen to what he says to them in reminding them. And they were all of the Jewish faith, all right? So they would have known of Abraham, and they would have known of those things. And he brings them back to this in chapter 4 of Romans. And he said, "For because of Abraham and because of his faith to believe that God was going to take all the guilty things in his life and make them right." And remember, if you don't know much about the history, Abraham lived a lot of years before Jesus. And so he had to have faith of what God was going to do in the future. And so this is what he said. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. Righteousness, do you know what that word really comes down to? Okay, it's being right before God. It's being made right. It's being forgiven. All right, it's being forgiven. And the words it was credited to him, in other words, his faith, it had to be put on his account, paid in full, before Jesus had ever come to this earth. But because of his faith, he believed it. And so it was given to him that way. And it was written not for him alone, but also for who? Okay, no. I appreciate your enthusiasm for those of you who spoke. But this is good news. It says it were not written for him alone, but it also was written for who?
Us.
That's right, us. That's us. That's me. It's been written for me, to whom God will credit righteousness. He can do that for me. And I love this. For us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. He gives us that righteousness. He puts it on our life. He changes it. And this is where it comes down to. You wonder why this is so relevant? See, forgiveness takes care of the responsibility you have for the sin in your life. Forgiveness, being forgiven, that's awesome. But this part's amazing. He goes, he was delivered over to death for our sins. right? People, I mean, it's easy to believe that Jesus died. And even people believe he died for sins. But if he really died for sins so that sins could be paid for and forgiven, he had to be risen. This is what it says. And was raised to life for our, big word, justification. Justification. This is why he had to die and raise from the dead, because his resurrection brought justification. All right, let me show you. Justification takes away the guilt for our sin. That's what takes away the guilt, being guilty. That's the judge picking up the gavel and saying, case dismissed. Not guilty. Every wrong thing in my life, everything that I have ever done, when I receive Jesus into my life, not guilty. Every time I lied, not guilty. Every time I cheated or thought of something wrong, when I've had a bad thought in my mind, not guilty. Justification. That's what resurrection did for us. Takes away. The resurrection of Jesus is what can make guilty people guilt-free. Guilt-free. So we shouldn't live in guilt. I'm afraid that even followers of Jesus many times let guilt for the sin that they commit and the things that they do, rather than walking every day in the power of the resurrection and the justification that comes for us to make us not guilty anymore, instead of letting that weigh us down and hold us back from serving him and doing the things he wants, what do? We end up finding ourselves weighted down and not doing anything for him because we're not living in that justification that Jesus made possible through his resurrection. So, some people, the skeptics may say, but isn't that kind of rewarding bad behavior? Okay? I have a third grade teacher. I'm sure she says this. All right? Isn't that rewarding bad behavior? You must pay for your wrong. You must pay. Yes, there's always consequences, but when it comes to the true punishment and being held responsible, then you're forgiven. And when it comes to the being guilty, you're justified. And I got to tell you, it's not rewarding bad behavior. It's actually reconciling a broken relationship. Hallelujah. That's what God is doing. What was he thinking? Why did he want us to do this? Jesus' example on the cross was, Father, forgive them. He showed his disciples. He forgave them for backing away. This is amazing to me how he looked at the people who had done this, and he was begging God to forgive them for their sin. They didn't even know that they had been nailing the Son of God to a cross and executing him. They didn't realize that. They couldn't see it. Reconciling a broken relationship, that's what it's all about. See, we were created to have a relationship with God, and he knew the only way was to step in there. And he says, not guilty. I know they can't pay for it. Just like the judge in Providence. And you know the example he then gives to us? The things that we should hear, Paul wrote to the Ephesian church and said, this is the way Jesus wants you to treat each other. He says, be kind and compassionate to one another. And what's the word? Forgiving each other. Just as in Christ, God forgave you. See, the whole idea is this is how we live it out. This is what makes it possible. The resurrection makes it possible for you to forgive anybody what they've done. Just think of it. The resurrection of Jesus is what can make forgiven people forgiving. That's what can change. See, you may be thinking, and honestly, bitterness may be what is rooted deep in your heart, a hardness because of somebody doing something wrong to you, or they've hurt you, or they've said something bad about you. They called you out on social media. You didn't like it, and you unfollowed them. Ooh. The resurrection makes it possible to forgive any situation or circumstance. What was God thinking? What was he thinking? Dying for guilty people. You know, I mean, a resurrection from the dead. I mean, what was he thinking? What's the why? What's the why? Why did he do this? One huge word. One incredible, weight-lifting word. Forgiveness for every person. Why is the resurrection of Jesus relevant to our lives today? Forgiveness. That's why. And we shouldn't walk in guilt. We shouldn't feel that, because when Jesus died on the cross, he took our sin. When he was buried, it showed that he was truly dead. But when he woke up and came out of that grave alive in the body he had lived in, he made it possible for the case against us to be dismissed.
Amen.
We should walk and live in that every day. And when we look at the other people around us, we should look at them and say, case dismissed. God forgave me. I can forgive you. Let me pray for you, please. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed for just a moment, I want you to take time. I'm not going to ask you to make a decision of any kind. I'm not going to do anything like that right now. But I will say that God's arms are wide open to you. If you feel guilty today, he will take your guilt away. All you got to do is believe that Jesus rose from the dead, that he died for your sin. Confess that you want him to be the leader of your life, the forgiver of your sins. But I want you to think of this. You can live in this resurrection power, this justification that he made possible to make you guilt-free. You can live in that every day. You can live in it every day. Ask him to do that in your life right now. You know, Jesus, I am so grateful that this morning we can stand here knowing that forgiveness is possible, that our faith isn't futile, that we're not to be pitied. Oh, God, thank you. Oh, those words that I hate to say, but Lord, I don't have to say them in regards to what we know about you. We're not to be pitied. We're not to think that our faith is futile, because Jesus did raise from the dead. And thank you for doing that for us. And God, I pray for every person in this room that may be wallowing in guilt or living in guilt every day. If they're a follower of you, God, I pray that they'll live in that resurrection forgiveness, that resurrection justification, and live with power, knowing that, God, you can bring about incredible things in their life. And I pray for the person maybe who has yet to trust you as their leader, as their forgiver. God, I pray that today might be the day they would trust you. Lord, thank you that you took death and you put it down. You arrested it, Lord, and we're grateful for that. It's in your name I pray. Amen. With joyful hearts, would you stand and let's sing this.
Your love made a way to let mercy come in. Sing it out like we mean it. Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand.
It's a great, it's an incredible life-giving thing to believe that Jesus is alive. Listen, we're glad you are here today, especially if you are a guest. Please join us back at Guest Connect today. I won't take a lot of your time, but I want to meet you, and I look forward to seeing you there. And then just to let you know this too, one of the things that's really awesome about being together like this is that you get to do it weekly. And so we want to invite you to come back again and be here with us next Sunday. And we're excited about next Sunday because not only are we changing our time, we're actually moving. 9:15 is going to stay the same. So if you showed up at 9:15, yes, which you did, okay? And then 9:15, and then the second service will start at 10:45. So if you're thinking maybe you could go either way on that, please maybe consider going to second service. That will help us out on our crowd, all right? That would be awesome if you could do it. And if you're wondering, would it be worth it to come back next Sunday? Well, I don't know. Watch and see.
got stolen by the grave robber. Pick me up from that rock bottom. Wash my soul in that holy water. Brought me back to life. One more stone rolled away. One more sinner been saved by grace. This dead man, he ain't dead no longer. All because of that grave robber. That you'll never be right. Even though your mama praying for you every night, praying Jesus gonna find you and open your eyes. Well, maybe right now's out.